All right, friends, so let's start now. And we yesterday have downloaded these two softwares. The first one is the JDK, and we want JDK 8. There are a lot of, JDK 13 is also available, the latest one, but we need minimum level of JDK is 8, so I'm sticking to that. More stable. That's the only reason. Then we also have downloaded Hadoop software. Now, you have the instructions shared with you people in a text file that's there in your LMS. Hope you have downloaded. Open this particular text file from your Big Data Sessions folder, installation document, and we will be following this installation's instructions, right? All these things for setting up Hadoop instance in a single node. And we basically are going to set up something called as pseudo cluster. That means we are going to imagine that this server that we are using right now, the local system that we are using right now, is a cluster in itself. It's a single system, but we are basically assuming that it is a cluster in itself. And we will have all the services running in the cluster. What all services will be there? Name node, data node, secondary name node, resource manager, and finally we'll have node manager. So all these five daemons or five services will run in a single system. Okay, functionality wise there will be no difference. Ultimately these are the Java processes which run on a server. But remember, as we discussed, rather than having these multiple computers, we cannot invest heavily on the hardware. So we are using a single system and imagining that we are working with cluster. Okay, this is called as pseudo cluster. Right? So let us first set up Java. Now, Java environment is very much required for us to execute these softwares or install these softwares and take the advantage of those background Java services. So for that, the first and foremost step is get the Java software from Oracle website that we have yesterday done. We have extracted. Now we will install this. Now to install the software, we need to first extract it. We are seeing .tar file. .tar basically means it's a compressed file. Like we have .rar, similarly we'll have .tar. Default zip option. We also have .gz. Gz is basically gun zip. Gzip. Now, in order to extract this software, you can just say right click, right? And you can click on open with archive manager. Right? So it is like your WinRAR, right? You open the WinRAR, you see the content inside it. So you will get this folder when you unzip it. Now, remember, I said we will be using Linux commands for doing any kind of transactions on here. But I'm also showing you the front end option, graphical user interface options as well. If you are comfortable doing the extraction there, you please go ahead. But I would recommend typing. Now, in the Linux commands script that I have yesterday shown, we have something related to tar. tar files. How do we handle tar files? Right? So C means compress, X means extract, right? So we are going to use this command, tar, we want to extract the zip file. You see Z, extract a tar using, is using Z, gzip. So this is a gzip file, so we say xz. And then we have v, or v can be later on applied. Then we have f. F means force. You can say force or file. When you try to unzip any files in Windows, right, extract it, it will ask for confirmation, right? This is the type of file. Do you want to compress all these files? If there is a different type of file, then again it will ask for a confirmation. So we do what? Extract for all. We do it right? Zip, unzip for all. So that is this F. For each file, if you have subfolders and subfiles and all that that are zipped, when you're doing extraction, it is going to ask for confirmation on each and every file whether you want to unzip it. So I don't want to prompt, I don't want that prompt. So we will say F, we'll simply say F, X, Z, F. And then if I use the first letter, I'm just typing the first letter and hitting tab. So this is the autofill command which is there in Linux terminal. It's auto typing the entire file name because it is the only file which is starting with J, letter J. So I just typed J, I'll show you again. I just typed J and then tab, autofill. If I do this, then in the back end, the file is getting extracted. It's not showing what the files are getting extracted. Right? Now if I say ls, you can see I got the folder. Okay, so let me remove it and redo it. Okay, I'm doing the extraction again, but this time I will apply something called as v. V means verbose. That means it has to prompt on the screen on which file it is extracting. So I'll say tar xz vf and then the file name. So you can see each and every file that the command is extracting is shown on the screen. That's verbose, v. If you say ls, you get that file. Similarly, I will be extracting Hadoop file. Same command, tar xzvf or zxvf. So hope you are practicing on these scripts, these commands. Yeah, so if you do that, it will be very clear. We are trying to extract the softwares which are provided to us in a zip format, compressed format. This is how we do it in command prompt. As I mentioned, you can also do it on the front end option as well. All you have to do is what? Right click and say open with archive manager. So you have both the folders extracted. This is the downloads folder, right? I don't want to have the softwares that I'm going to use in downloads folder. In Windows, whenever you have any important folders or any files or any installations that you're doing, you want to set it up in a specific location, right? Same way here also, I want to save or I want to store all the files related to Hadoop software in a specific folder. right? I will create another terminal. You can create as many terminals as you wish. You can say new window. Right click on the terminal and say view window or new tab. Or you can go to terminal here and say new window or new tab. So this is a new window. Shortcut is also there. Keyboard shortcut is Control Shift N. Control Shift T is new tab. Control Shift N is new window. Now I'm in downloads folder. I will go one folder out. This is my folder structure, right? So if I come here, I'm going to my home directory. This is the main directory, right? Now in this directory, I want to right click and say new folder. Some folder where all my Hadoop related files and folders that I'm going to create will be residing. I don't want to put anything outside. So rather than doing the job from the graphical user interface, I'm going to type mkdir. And you might want to give any name. Let me just quickly peep into this and see what is the name that I've given. I'm going to put this as big data folder. Mkdir big data will create a folder called big data here. Right? You can see that folder is created. Right? Now, I have created the folder, but my files that I want to store, basically the folders, are here in downloads directory. Now, how do I move this? I can just say cut, go to that folder where my, right, this folder, and then say paste. Right? I'm not doing this, I'm typing the same thing in a terminal. So all I will do is identify where my files and folders are there. So here I want to move, let's say JDK folder. First, I'm trying to move this one folder, right, to what location? Big data location. But where is that big data? It is outside this folder. So how do I go one folder out? If I am there in downloads, how do I go one folder out? What command should I give? Cd dot dot, exactly. Cd dollar or cd enter would directly take me to the home directory. I'm not doing that. I want to go one folder outside this, right? So if you see pwd here, it says slash home slash user 2 downloads, whereas here I have one folder out. So I'm going to type in that here. I want to move this content one folder out, and here at this level I have a folder called big data. So into that big data I want to copy. Right? Actually, you have to basically type in, because these two names are different. In terminal, it would be really difficult to do that. You have to type it separately. If you have same names, you can do that. Or if you want to copy everything, then you can say star. Rather than this, if you put star here, everything will be copied. Only two files, then it's really difficult because the names are different. So when I entered that, the folder is moved into this big data folder now. You can see that. Right? Similarly, I will do it in another way. I'm in big data folder. Right, I want to get a folder, the software, Hadoop software, which is in downloads folder, right? So how do I do that? I'll say again, move. What do you want to move? You want to move a folder which is inside this folder. What is that folder? Hadoop folder. Where do we want to move it? To this location. This location means dot. So you either be in that folder, the source folder, and point to the folder where you which you want to move to a destination, or you can also do it like this. You stay in the destination and give the complete path of the source and then say dot. Or you can be in some other folder and then you can give source and directory, sorry, source directory and destination directory, and then execute it. Yes, we can do that, Shruti. From the front end, we can do that. Yeah. This is terminal commands, right? It's like Windows command prompt, remember? So this is my folder, big data, and both Hadoop and JDK are here. I've just downloaded the software. I've not installed or configured this. Now, when I say installation of a software, what does that actually mean? In Windows, we will have a .exe file. We download a small executable and double click it. And in the back end, this .exe is going to run a bunch of scripts which either extract the data from that executable file, or it is going to connect to some location and then download the software and then store those library files or the executable files into the system. Now, the same thing is manually done here. Just take that entire software and place it in your folder. Right? This is installation process. Now, on this, remember, we just have the software in our system, but you need to declare that to the system, and then you should be able to use that software in your system. So how do I do that? So yesterday I talked about ENV. Remember, I'll use this terminal. To clean the screen, I'll say Control L. Control plus L will clean the screen. Doesn't mean that deleting everything, it's just taking you to the first line. Control plus L. Now, yesterday we did env. This is the environment file or environment command, which talks about the settings of this particular user by default, right? Default settings. So, for example, I come to your home, right? There are certain things in your home which are by default available, I mean set up. If I go to some other person's home, the settings will be different, right? The environment will be different. My home, my environment will be different. So when you say ENV, those default settings for the user are shown here, right? This is by default done by the system, and this happens because whenever you open the terminal, it is going to install, it is going to execute this file. Bash RC. Dot means hidden file, remember? So every time you open a new terminal, fresh terminal, the terminal will first execute this bash RC file and then give you the environment, right? So the commands that I'm doing, ls, pwd, cp, mv, tar, all these are scripts which are stored in a location. If I say which, ls. Ls is a function which is available in this binary for location. System for, right? Similarly, you talk about pwd, which pwd. When you say which, it is basically giving you the script, right? If I execute this, cat is to read the content, okay? I'm just reading the content of pwd file. This is an executable like this. You'll not be able to read it, of course. But this is the script, right? Shell script. And when you type the command, that shell script is executing and you're getting the output. Now, how does computer know that there is a script called PWD and it needs to be executed? You're not directly executing that file, right? You're typing PWD, that's it. And when you see which PWD, that PWD is in this location, but you're not going there to execute the file, isn't it? So you will be able to execute all the list of commands that we are doing right now because the environment is preloaded for us. It is set for us, right? And one of those important scripts which allow us to do this is the variable name called path. So when you do env here, let me show you. Where is the path variable? Yeah, look at this. This is the path variable. You can store multiple values to a variable. But if you are loading these multiple variables, then you have to put colon. So path, this is also there in Windows, I've shown you, right? Environment files, system environment files. So this path variable is preloaded with all these locations where you have the scripts, binary files. Right, all these scripts that are there in different locations, we are defining those locations automatically. Right, hence we are able to do this. Remember path variable, very, very important variable. Okay, now I can see the values of one specific variable, let's say path. Then I can say echo dollar path. If I want to set a value, then I will say export. We'll see that. We'll say export the variable name. Without spaces, you have to put equal to symbol, and then give the path. That would basically give the value, sorry. That would basically define the variable. It could be any variable, right? In Python programming or any programming language, we have a variable. Same way in Python, same way in Linux also, we have these variables. Okay, that's about variable systems. Now, in order to look into the Java, if you remember, I said which Java? Yesterday, I was talking about this Java, right? This Java is available in the folder user bin Java. And if I see the version of this particular Java, it is 180.222, but it is a OpenGDK option that we have. Right? And this OpenGDK will not allow you to do a development. Though it is a JDK, it's not a full one, full version. So we need to use this software that we have downloaded here. Right? And this software that I have downloaded, I've stored it in Big Data, JDK. And if I go into the JDK, you can see this software and I have binary files in bin folder. If I come here, I go to JDK, this is the folders, and I have bin folder. Within the folder, I have binary executables. These are all the executable scripts. Right? Now, if I can somehow give the executable here, this Java is a file. You can see if I say ls you know, listing happens, right? But if I say ls user bin, then look at that. All these are the files or values that we have in user bin folder. User bin folder. If I say j star, all the values which start with j are going to be shown here. Right? User bin java is what I want. So user bin java is there. If I say user bin java ls, it's showing like this. If I say ls hyphen l, it will show that it is a link. And it is showing us to the software. This is the OpenJDK software which is available, and you can see here it is a script, right? Now I want to somehow point to this Java location when I say which Java. So I'm just modifying the, I'm trying to modify the environment. Now in order to do that, I need to set this location because my file is there in this location, right? This location has to be set to the variable path. But make sure you do not replace these values with this value, because there are various other executables which are defined here. So we have to append the value. We have to add the value to the existing list. But when I add, by default, we try to add at the end. But if you do that, then when the Linux operating system is trying to find out Java, it goes in the sequential order and it finds Java in user bin folder because it is coming first. So it picks up the Java, right? And I don't need that. That is the reason why we are installing the new software. I don't need the old one. Hence, when you are appending this value, we need to put this value at the first position, at the beginning of this set of values, right? And in order to do that, we use export function. This is a variable, right? So system variable. So I'm going to alter that variable by adding this folder at the first location. Right? How to get into bin path? CD is the change directory. This is the location. Where is the location? It is in the location of the software that we have extracted. Extraction, right? We extracted the software. And we place that file in one folder, specific folder. You cannot type the same thing, Shruti. It's your system could have different path, right? The folder structure and all that will be different for you. Okay. Did you extract the software, Shruti? Yes. Did you replace, did you position that software from the downloads folder to some other folder? Now open that folder. If you open that folder, you have been. How to do it in Windows? It's a software. Within the software, I'm trying to see what files I have. When I open it, I have a bin folder. Within that bin folder, I have all this. Bin is just one folder. I have man, I have JRE and all that. Yeah. Why not? Please, sir, raise your arm. Raise your hand.
Shure, sorry, I lost between. I mean, network got lost. I see that you are in the bin, the very top command. No, I know where you're pointing me to. Physical bin, I can see, but command wise, I don't get into the bin. You see, user 2 at the rate HTTP space bin. I'm not getting into that bin.
Sorry, come again. This one.
Yeah.
That is which, when you say which Java in your system, it is showing the location.
Yeah, but you are in the bin and you're typing in which Java, right? I'm not able to get into that bin, I'm saying.
This bin is different. See, when I did PWD, where I am in this location, right? When I did which Java, it is showing this different location. So I'm trying to say that Linux gives us by default a Java. Yesterday I've shown you, remember? Which Java is giving me this location, and I say Java-version. It is OpenGDK software, which by default your CentOS software is giving. Okay, we don't want this. I'm saying we don't want this because it is not full version. So for that reason, we are downloading a full version of JDK from Oracle website. And I've downloaded that, extracted that, placed here in this location. So forget about bin location. I'm somewhere. When I say which Java, it has to give me what is the Java which is defined for this environment. This is a session. This is an environment. So in this session, I have this. Now, what I'm trying to explain is this, which Java executing, is giving this result. This result is basically being picked up from this environment variable. Path is an environment variable which is holding all these location details. So when I say Java, it is trying to look into this folder. If it finds, it will print that location. If it is not finding, then it comes here and checks. Did not find, it comes here and checks. And it found that there is a Java executable file. Making sense now? Shruti? Not audible, Shruti. Okay. I think her network is gone again. Okay. How to move Pavan in Windows, what you do, Pavan, if you have to move the folder? You can do that. Did you practice on these commands? That is the reason why you are not able to understand and you're not focusing when we are talking about it. Focus, guys, you can do it later also if you want. This is the command, line number 20. This is the command that I have typed in the terminal to get the folders moved from one location to another location. Right? This is one way to do it. This is another way to do it. Where from different location, I'm trying to copy and cut and paste the files. Or if you feel this is too much, I don't want to do all that. Just come here, right click, use cut, go to the folder, do paste. This is anyways, GUI is always there. Okay, so practice commands, guys. you try and understand the logic, and please practice the commands. If you don't practice it, tomorrow you'll lose it again. You'll forget, right? Okay. So now, see, moving and all that, I'm doing it in terminal so that you get practice. Okay, all this can be done from graphical user interface. Don't worry on these steps. More practice you do, you'll be able to do all these things. So coming to the important point here in the installation or configuration of your Hadoop services is that I need to position, or I need to point to this JDK folder that you are seeing here, right? This software should be referred by any user who is coming into this user, this ID. User 2, I'm logging into the system. Then I should be able to use only this, not this. So I have to alter this variable, $path variable, in such a way that I get the new Java folder here at the first position. Okay? And that too, not for once, but I need to have it right every time I log in. Now, for one-time activity, I will show what we need to do here. So the command that I'm going to type now is called as export. Export path variable. Already I have a path variable defined, right? So I don't want to rename, completely change it, but I want to add the location here. What is the location? Slash home. Why is it not working? Export path is equals to slash homes slash. Slash home slash user 2 slash big data. Then I have the folder JDK. Then I have the folder bin. Right? So I'm trying to enable my path variable to add this location. Plus, remember, I want to add only. So my old values have to be here. So I will say $path. This is basically means I'm appending the value, this value, the location of the new software, JDK software, bin folder to this path variable, which is already defined, right? So export command should not have this space. So I've exported this. Now, if you see echo $path, this location is coming in the first position. So if I say which Java, you see that Java location that we installed is showing, and you can see Java-version. This is one-time activity, because if I go to this terminal, and if I say which Java, the old Java is only shown. Right? I don't want this to happen. I want the new Java version to be hard-coded every time I want to use this user. Right? So in order to do this, we go to the home directory. Home directory. Within the home directory, we will have those bash files, system files. For every user, you will have the system files, right? Which will hold the settings. Now I'm going to edit the bashrc file, gedit.bashrc. Remember, in production environments, you will only edit bash profile, not bashrc. Okay. Here it is okay, it's not production environment. So gedit.bashrc. But remember to have a habit before editing any system file, or for that matter, any file, or any folder for your settings, I mean, you, if you are altering something, make sure you take a backup. Backup is nothing but copy. Bash RC, you can give any name, backup. I generally have this habit to give the date. This is a hidden file. So you see bash RC is the original file and this is the backup file. Next, I open the bash RC, gedit, so it will open in notepad. And in this notepad, we are saying Hadoop settings. User specific aliases and function. This hash basically means comment. So it says any custom settings you want to have, you can have it here. So I'm having Hadoop settings. Under Hadoop, the first one is Java. So I'm basically setting up Java. So whatever the command that I have done there, export path is equal to /home/user2/dictator/whatever that file name is. Why is this coming here? Then say $:. Now, very, very important, guys. If you don't put this, then you'll not be able to use your user at all. Next time when you log in, you'll not be able to use it. You'll not even be able to type ls command also. Okay, path variable is very, very important. So you have to append the value to path variable. But do you think it is apt to use the complete name like this? Not really, right? So what I can do here is, I can set up a variable, a custom variable. Here I'm going to say it as Java home, and I'm pointing this location. And then I will use this variable here. I'll say $:javahome:$path. This is easy. And from now on, whenever I have to refer to this folder, JDK folder, I will use Java home, this variable name, right? But Java home is only the folder name. Inside it, I have this bin file. Bin folder. We need to point to that bin folder because executable files or binary files are there under this bin folder location. So till here it is Java home. After that you have bin. So you need to mention that here. And then colon. Save this. You save this and you can close it. Now, if your bash RC file is updated, it is not dynamically reflecting into the current environment. It doesn't happen here. For example, if I now say which Java, it is still pointing to the old one. Right? But if I open a new window, a new terminal here, see? And if I now say which Java here, in a new terminal, why is it not reducing? Yeah. So in the new fold, new terminal, the settings are taken into effect, but the existing terminals will not get the effect changed. So what we do is we go to that home location where you have that bash rc file that you just updated. You need to execute this, and to execute you say source dot file name, source space dot bash rc. Now the environment, this setting, this file is executed, so the new changes that have been updated to bash rc will take into effect. Look at that. So just to show you in big font, let me open that bash rc in this. I'm adding these two values. These are given in the folder here. So gedit bash rc and update these. This folder will be different, path will be different, but the idea is something that you have to take it. Okay, this is the folder. Do this change. Everyone, is it done? Let me know. Now just follow the instructions, Shruti, which are there in this installation document. The rest of the things you can come back and review the video, and you'll get to know that. You might want to follow that document, installation document. Yeah, others, is it done? Everyone else? Do it. That's okay, Shruti. What I'm saying is, forget about all that we discussed. Open bash rc file and update this thing. We will try to make up on the last concept. Just follow these instructions. At least the installation will be complete. Okay, what happened, guys? Everyone done? Okay, two people confirmed. Gedit. Open a file using gedit, and that dot bash rc file will be there in the home directory. Guys, is it that difficult? What about others? How do you edit a file, guys? Text file. Why is it taking so much time? I come to home directory. Open the file. What file? It's a hidden file. We can see it's the hidden file. How do I open a file? I'll say gedit.bashrc, the file name. It will open. And we are typing these commands. You can also get these commands from this text file, which is there in the LMS, Hadoop installation.txt. So you can scroll down to, right, a little down here. You can see gedit.bashrc command, and then these are the Java settings that we are doing. First line should be updated with the appropriate folder names, path. The second line can be copied as is. Same thing, as is. No change. Yeah. Is it clear now? You imagine that you are working with Windows, guys. Forget about that. There is something called as Linux operating system. Yeah, done. Bash RC, not bash underscore RC. Do ls hyphen LA or hyphen A. Ls space hyphen A. It will list out the hidden files. There you will see the name is bash RC. And it should not throw error when you say gedit. It's like opening a note, empty notepad. If you say gedit with empty new file name. What error is it throwing? Okay. Yeah. LS command is not found. Okay. You edited something path. That's, yeah, the above line where you have edited the path variable that goofed up. This is the error that you'll get, guys. See, if you observe here, export path is equals to this line that you see, both line, any line, is changed the default path settings. Remember, I said we need to add the value. So you need to actually have to do colon dollar path. That appending was not done. So now what is happening is you'll not be able to use any of the default commands. Now, one solution is we need to log into your user as root user. Says su, enter. Oh no. Okay. Go to that power option at the top. Yeah, click on that. Click on user one. Okay, you can say log out. That would also not work, Nabil, because path variable is not working. It's completely gone. There is not, no. Wait. Cancel. There is not listed there. Click on that. Say root. Yeah, enter. And do you remember the root password? Remember I said you have to make sure you remember it. Yeah. Hope you have taken the Bash RC backup. Okay, yeah. Go to terminal, open terminal, we'll see. Say cat space. Oh, okay, finish this. First time you're logging, right? You will get all this. Remove the privacy. Skip. Yeah, close it. Cat space dot bash rc. Enter. Okay, you see. One second. And it's your screen. One second. Let me cross check. Okay. You see that source global definitions part? The last part. Yeah, from there. You can copy that. Okay, do one thing. Okay, go to CD space /home/ your username. Yeah. Enter. Here you can say cat space again dot bash rc. Enter. This seems to be fine. Nothing has changed. Okay, fine. No, nothing to change. But if you have edited this file, then you will have to change here like this. Using root username, you have to do it. Okay. Did you change this file, Shruti, or how did you do that? I've given you unmute option.
Yeah. I don't know.
Okay, let's see. It should work. It should
work. I just typed in whatever the command I saw on your screen.
Okay, it should work. Just exit this user. Again, same way. Control. Power, sorry. Power. Root. Log out and then log into the user, and it should work now.
Okay.
So change, make sure you copy bash rc as a backup.
VMware is very slow, Sharad.
Yeah, I mean resources. Your computer resources are affecting this. Do ls. Yeah, it's working. So no problem. Your bash rc is fine. First save. Cp. Copy command has to be used. Your bash rc file has to be backed up. How do you copy a file? Bash rc.
Enter.
Yeah, space, your backup file name. You're copying that file to something as a backup.
So it could be anything.
You can give any name, bash rc under dot backup. Dot file. Mouse will not work. Space. No. Space. After space. Dot. Bash rc. Underscore or hyphen backup. You're copying bash rc so that any changes that you're doing will not edit the main file. If you corrupt anything, you will have a backup file. That's the logic here.
Okay. Enter.
Enter, yeah. That's it. Follow this text file that I have given, right? Open the text file. Yes. What does it say? Gedit bash rc and type these export commands. Two commands that we have.
This first too?
Yes, that too, but make sure that the path is given with the right directory names. /home/user1/bigdata/jdk180_12211 is given here. For our software, it is different. So that folder names have to be correctly given. In bash rc, we have to do that.
So I need to type in
gedit bash rc. Come to the bottom of the file then update here, paste it here, but the folder name has to be correctly given.
Where can I find this folder name? I mean within the,
how do you find the folder?
No, I know what you mean.
So go, that's okay, go there, check it. Make sure the folder name is correctly given.
Right. So it should be _281.
Yes, it should not be 211, it should be 281. Yes. Hope everyone else is following what Shruti is doing. That's it. Save the file. Hope your username is also user one.
Yes, it is user one.
Okay. Okay, done. And you have created the big data folder? Yes, you have created. I've seen that. Yeah.
Yeah. Within big data folder, these two are there.
Yes, perfect. So you're given the right location. You save it, close it.
Save it.
That's it.
Right.
Now to make sure the changes that you have given to BashRC to take into effect, you need to source the file or execute the file. So you say source space dot BashRC. Enter. Now if you say cd space dollar Java underscore home in caps. Variable is always in uppercase. Java also. Enter. So why is it not going? Okay. See, do echo echo space dollar Java home. Enter. Okay. Open BashRC file again. Gedit BashRC. You've given, right? Why is this file not taken? Okay. Okay. Wait. That export path, it should be export Java home is equals to first one. Yes. That should be Java home in uppercase.
I see.
Okay, save it. It's not going to work again. Make sure you are taking the backup file. Do CP. No, don't execute. You have to do the reverse way. If you do it again, you have to go to root. You have to change the source as backup, destination as BashRC. You're basically reverting the changes. You're taking the backup into the original location. You understood, right, what you're doing now?
Yes.
So the changes that you made to your BashRC are reverting. You're taking your backup to original. Yes, enter. And now again open Gedit and make sure that the Java settings are correctly given.
Oh, do I need to open the BashRC file again?
Yes.
So execute this command?
Yes. Gedit, yeah. So copy those correct commands. Two 81 should be there. That's it. Save it. You can check echo space dollar Java home. Again not working. Why? Oh, source, we did not do source, sorry. Source. Yeah. Now do echo dollar space dollar Java home. Yeah, got it. So if we do it correctly, it is only 2-3 steps. Which will it, you, everybody will catch it up. It's because first time you're doing, these are a little confusing. Don't worry on these things, friends.
In real time, do they have to do all this, Sharon?
Sorry?
In real time, do they set up all this and give us a system, or do we have to do it ourselves?
No, you're not doing it. No. Remember, you're not administrator. You don't have to do it.
Okay.
You so can now check which Java and Java... Sorry?
So why do we need, why should we practice all these commands?
You're not practicing it, you're setting up an environment so that you can practice on Hadoop.
Yeah, but we, okay, do we need to memorize these commands?
No, not at all.
No, right? Okay.
You don't have to memorize, but these are Linux commands. From the commands perspective, yes, you kind of understand these commands.
Yeah.
Hadoop setup is something that is not expected from a data scientist.
All right.
Yeah, Jyotsna. What's the question that you had? Yes, Jyotsna. Hello. Hello, Jyotsna, you had a question. Are you there? Please raise your hand. If you raise your hand, it will be easy for me to give you the unmute option. Jyotsna, waiting. Is your question resolved, Jyotsna, or still not resolved? Resolved, okay. The folder location is something that you have to check, Shilpa. Are you sure the same folder is there in your system? /home/user1/bigdata/JDK180_281. And did you give space here? After Java home, did you give space? If you give space, remove that space. Without space, you have to give that. Yeah, just cross-check that once. Right. So, friends, what we have done right now is only setting up Java environment, which is mandatory for us to have, so that we can have our Hadoop setup. Okay. Now, in the same bash rc file, which is there in this home directory, I'm going to make Hadoop settings also. Hadoop related settings. So I'm basically using this sheet which is provided to me because a lot of content is there that I need to copy and type. So rather than typing everything, I'm using this text file, copying that content here. Why is it not pasting? Okay, for me it is not pasting, so let me type in everything. I have to do it in the hard way. Not sure why it is not pasting anything. Right. For you guys, if it is working, just make sure you are going to use this copy paste option. Just copy that and make sure you're giving the right path here, -2.10.1. Okay, that's my first line, Hadoop home. Then I'm saying yarn also, right? Remember Hadoop components, I have Hadoop home, yarn home, sorry, Hadoop contains three components, HDFS, yarn and MapReduce. So I'm exporting yarn underscore home to Hadoop underscore home. So same folder, my software is same, both for both the Hadoop home and yarn home, the binary files, the software is same, right? So I'm using simply this variable to point to this location. Then I need to copy and paste these two. It's really troubling me. It's not allowing me to copy paste. I'll try to do this. Copy this. Let me drag it here and see if I can do that. It's not working. So this is the problem, guys. Sometimes VMware will not allow you to copy paste. Not working. When this happens, I generally restart the virtual machine, but now it cannot happen. So let me type it the way I do it. Hadoop common underscore lib. Okay, native directory, sorry, my bad. You just have to copy paste, guys. Don't change anything. Just make sure the only this location you are giving it in the right folders are have to be passed here. Right folder locations have to be given. Rest of the things, you just make sure you're copy pasting everything from here to there. Okay, lib native directory is equals to $hadoop home / it will be easy for me to type in like this. /. Open lib / native / export. Hadoop underscore dir is equals to $Hadoop chrome/etc/. Then you will say export the path. This time I don't need to have Hadoop location at the start, starting stage. So I can first import the existing path values using $path. Then I'll say colon Hadoop home slash bin colon $Hadoop home slash sbin. And then say export path is LD library path is equals to $Hadoop home/lib/native:. Okay. So if you are able to copy paste this content, just copy paste it. Make sure that the Hadoop location is currently given and save the bash RC. So what we are doing is we are basically defining the software for environment. When I say environment, as soon as you log in using this user, these softwares will be usable because they are defined in my system file, right? In the environment. Done. So once these settings are basically the content is copy pasted, you can save it and close it, right? So here you have edited the bash RC. You are in the home directory. So we do source.bashrc. This will make sure that the settings that we have done, right? The Hadoop settings that we have done are taken into effect. I can directly go to Hadoop home folder. From my home directory, directly I'm coming inside this particular folder using the variable Hadoop_name that I have defined in bashrc. Same goes with Java also, right? So now what we did, we installed the software into our Linux environment. But in order to use Hadoop services, we need to configure it. Those configuration steps are given here. Okay, so once you say source or bashrc, it will set up your environment and you'll be able to use Hadoop services from now on. Next. Whenever we talk about storage component in Hadoop, we have name node and data nodes, right? Name node and data nodes. And if it is in a clustered environment, even in the clustered environment, we will have same name node, data node, right? All across all the systems. Remember, it is a virtual layer that we are creating in a cluster. So this is folder. Right, all these are servers. So virtual layer is created as a disk storage. Right? And for the external user, this is the folder structure, not your local individual systems. Right? So here you are saying this is name node. You are giving a folder name. This is data node. But that folders physically also have to be executed here, and each computer which is interconnected here in the cluster should have the same folder structure. If you are doing it in cluster, then each node should have the same folder structure for name node folder and data node folder. And in name node folder, we will have metadata created. And in data node folder, we will have the actual data getting stored. So we create these folders. You can say mkdir and created. If you feel that, no, I'll not use mkdir, I'll come to this front end option and create these folder name. That's your choice. So here I'm going to create a folder and I'm calling it as Hadoop underscore distributed file system. Inside this folder, I'm going to create two folders. One I'm going to call as name node. The other one I'm going to call as data node. Right? So you either use that mkdir command to do it, or you use this front end option to create the folder. But this folder has to be there. Okay? Create it first. Then created the folders, both the folders, name node and data node. Oh, I did give the space, is it? Let me check. No, I think I corrected it later. I missed it. Huh? What did I miss? Oh, common lib native directory. Okay. Good catch. I missed this. These are anyways names, so that name can be anything, but fine. I'm giving the same name which I have given in the sheet. Any change that you're making to bash RC, if those changes have to be taken into effect, you have to execute source. Source.bashrc. Okay, so coming back, hope these folders are created. Now, after you created that folder, we have to go to the configuration location. Okay, in Big Data, in Hadoop software, right? This is your Hadoop software. The configuration files are located under etc. Okay, open the software. There you see the folder called etc. Open that folder etc. Then you'll have a folder again called Hadoop. If you open it, these are all the system files or configuration files for Hadoop. Now we are going to edit these files to give specific settings for our Hadoop environment. And that's how we basically start our environment. And the files that we edit are core-site.xml, hdfs-site.xml, yarn-site.xml. The older version of the Hadoop used to ask this also to be edited, where we need to set Java environment into this. But in the newer versions, this Java version is already set up. So we don't need to change anything in that file. But if you want to cross-check, you can right-click on this file and say, open with text editor. This is like gedit, that file name. We have seen gedit command, right? Same thing. Gedit this file name. If you open this file, this is the environment file, which basically requires this Java setting. But the script is written now in such a way that it picks up the Java environment from the bash RC file. System generated, right? We have edited that system bash RC file to give this setting. Java home is a variable which is already defined. So it is going to pick up that location from bash RC. You don't need to edit anything in this file. But in our script, we have said export these two. This is not required. By default, this is also given. Right? So you can skip Hadoop-env.sh file updation and come to the core-site.xml file. So I'll close this and I'll open this core-site.xml. That's the first file. It says open with Firefox. We don't want to open with Firefox. You can say open with other application. It's like open with option. And then say gedit or text editor, both mean same. And it will open it in the gedit screen. Gedit screen. This is an XML file and it has the syntax, right? Configuration/configuration, right? So that means this is the body in which the configuration settings should be there. It's an empty file, and into this empty file, we are going to add the content here. Configuration/configuration. Between that, we need to have these settings where we are saying property. What is the property? What is the name here of the property? It is file system default name. This is the argument. One of the properties, the properties first argument that you are defining is file system default name, FS default name. Now this here default name is nothing but this location. So you'll have to say value and then give that value here. This is the URL with 9000 as the default port number and HTTP is the host name. Whatever the host name that you have given to your system, you have to update that here. Till here, this is one property. Then the second property I have is DFS permissions. Distributed file system permissions, you're saying false. No file permissions are required, that's what you're saying. So copy this and paste it, if you can, into this script. For me, I'm not able to do again. I have to type everything. It's becoming too clumsy for me. Because by default, we will be doing these settings. And we will not have any changes to do. You just have to make sure you are giving that details correctly. If you give any wrong details here, everything, right, goes for a toss. It doesn't work, basically. It will not work. So it's fs.default.name. Hope I have given fs.default.name. And then we will have to say value. Value is http://, your host name, :9000. And then close that value. Now, if you are doubtful on what is your host name, you can see it here. Yesterday we discussed, right, username, host name. So my host name is HTTP. That's the reason I'm giving here HTTP. The port name is by default 9000 only. We need to give the 9000 only. Okay. So that's your. Sorry. This is not HTTP. This is HDFS. Hadoop Distributed File System. So this is the first setting and this is good enough. We don't need to, right, add the second property. But if you want to add the second property also, then do it. I'm copy pasting this and I'll say DFS permission. And the value is false. Okay, done. DFS.permissions false. So here I said permission, it has to be permissions. Okay, so make sure you're updating this. And yeah, thank you. I'm not sure if it works from there to here, but let's try. I'll try it. Let's see if it works. If it works for it's working. Very good. So for the next setting, we'll do that. Thanks, Shruti. All right. So this is setting done. The only change, guys, you need to do is the host name. Okay? So update that host name, save it. Then go for the second file that you need to edit, which is htfs-site.xml. This is the second file. Again, open with gedit. And here also you'll have the setting to be done. And remember, this htfs-site includes HDFS related settings. What are the HDFS related settings? Replication factor, block size, primarily these two. And there are n number of different things that we can do. Replication, by default, we are setting it as 1 here. DFS.replication, because it is a single node instance. This is a single node instance, right? So replication has to happen in a different node, not in the same node. Doesn't make sense, right? And if you're trying to do that, if you're trying to replicate it in the same folder, I mean same drive, then you're wasting your storage space. When you have actually cluster set up, when you have 4 nodes or 5 nodes or 10 nodes interconnected and then you are doing this cluster setup, then yes, having more replications will make sense. Right? So two reasons. One reason is because I have a single node, I don't have multiple nodes, there's no point having multiple replications. The other point is I don't want to waste my storage space. Right? Done. So, okay. Yeah, Ashnur. Ashnur, you have a question, is it?
Hello, sir. Good evening. For this replication node, for example, I have 3 servers. I just need to put 3 and I don't need to put the IP address of those 3 servers as long as they're interconnected, or do I need to put it in this file?
No IP addresses. You're not doing anything.
So, for example,
it's going to take it.
Okay, so it will automatically replicate itself on the other server.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
Okay, thank you, sir.
There's another file. I'll explain that. There is something called as masters and slaves file in the same folder. That would define, that would basically take care of the IP addresses, host names and all that. And replication factor is automatically taken care by Hadoop. Remember, we don't have the control. If you are doing the changes, then forget about it. It will not happen. If you have thousands of nodes, you will not be able to manually do, right?
Mm-hmm.
So no host names and nothing. You just give the replication factor. That's it.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, Shruti. Let me copy and paste this into my file here. Oops, it's not working. I think this was the copy that I had done in the previous. Okay, I cannot copy from the third part. I mean, other applications too. This VMware workstation. Sometimes you'll also face this problem, guys. In such cases, what you do is you restart your VMware. You just close this. So when you restart, you'll come to this location only. Probably that should resolve the solution issue. Now I'm not able to copy paste. Yeah, that's something that I'll do tomorrow, sort of. There's no point now doing it. I need to log into LMS and all that. So what we are doing is we are setting up this replication factor. So here, I would say my first property is DFS replication. Right? And here the replication factor, I'm setting it as 1. Okay, then again I'll have name node and data node values. The folder that I have created for name node and data node, right? We need to give that here. Yeah, so what is my name node file name? DFS name node dot name dot dir. So DFS dot name node dot dir dot name node. No. Name dot directory. So my bad. And then I have to give that path. The location where I have my DFS folder created. So I'll take this and paste it. Copy pasting is not working. It's really creating problem today. Slash name node. So this is for name node. Same thing, I'll do it for data node also. And here I'll say DFS data node. And the parameter is data node dir. And this will become data. So make sure the right locations are given. And these names are also correctly given, and save these changes. Okay. And the third file is the yarn file. The third file that I have to edit is yarn file. yarn-site.xml. Now here we need to do a copy paste again, and this is not going to happen for me today. I'll not be able to do it. You'll be doing it, guys. So what you do is copy paste this yarn content lot of things to type. I don't have that kind of energy. So copy paste, but make sure at the last three locations here, the right host name is given. For my system, I have given HTTP as the host name, right? For your system, whatever the host name you have defined, you need to give that host name here. Nothing else has to be changed. Only the host name has to be corrected into this setting. From property to slash property, you copy and paste it here. Within here, you can change, remove this. That's okay. These are the configuration settings, and there's a lot of things to be discussed. If anyone can follow this, then there are two more steps which will help us to start the services. Once the setting is done, we need to do formatting. It's like a new drive that we are creating, right? If I give you a flash drive, a new flash drive, you'll not be able to directly use it because there is, it's a, in raw format. It doesn't have any file system. So it will ask you to format first. And when you're formatting, it will ask you on what file system you want to have in that particular flash drive. And we generally say NTFS or FAT32. We used to do it. FAT32, but now we are saying NTFS. Here, that formatting and HTFS file system setup is being done using this command. Formatting the file system is done using HTFS name node hyphen format. So if you are done with this change, yarn-site.xml, then do this. Okay. And once you're doing this, you'll get a big update, and there it will say successful, format successfully completed. And if you see that message, that means your Hadoop has become ready for you to start using it. And these are the commands to start. And when you execute this, it will ask for the passwords as well. And once these commands are executed, you can type JPS, Java background processes, right? Which says Java processes. And those Java, that command should give you name node, data node, secondary name node, resource manager, and node manager. Don't worry about these IDs. These are only random IDs, system generated IDs. But you need to see these five services in that list, that mandatory. If these five services are up and are shown, that means your services are up and running for you to use them. Okay, don't do it now if you don't understand. Okay, if you are clear on what you are doing, then go ahead, do it. All right, fine. So we will complete the remaining settings from here, Yarn, again. I'll explain it again once. And then we will start the services once the installation and configuration is completed. Then we will do the hands-on, and we'll do this on Monday. Right. All right, so we'll wind up for the day. Yeah, in the meantime, make sure, guys, you complete detailed hands-on on this Linux commands. If you want to explore more, do explore more. Linux operating system is a open source. So a lot of Linux commands are readily available in Google as well. Okay. Core-site.xml, yes, you need to have the host name given here. That's the URL which points to your HDFS. So obviously, right, if you give my host name, how will your system understand HDFS, right? No, Shruti. See, the point is we need to understand the configuration files. We need to understand the logs. When you do this, you'll understand the folder structure and all that. That is the reason why I ask you people to do hands-on. But yeah, that's not going to happen, right? If you have 30 to 40 people, then it's really difficult to get all that. Yes, Saurav, we can do that, but this is one-time activity, right? You are doing the installation only once. Don't worry about that big hosting. That's okay. If you have given uppercase letters, special characters, spaces, then yes, you have to change it. It will not work out. Hostname has to be single word, lowercase letters, without any special characters. That's okay. That's absolutely fine, sir. Don't worry. Okay, you'll understand, Shruti, why I'm insisting on doing this hands-on. You'll understand that. As and how we proceed, right? You'll come to me. All right, we'll wind up. Thank you guys, and we'll connect again on Monday. Enjoy the weekend. Thank you. Good night, everyone.